sun in the middle. Now, this is a drawing. This isn't a real photograph. And each of these lines shows the path that one thing in our solar system follows around the sun. In the middle, we've got the planet Mercury going around on a nearly circular path, Venus, and here's the Earth highlighted. The Earth follows this path around the sun, driving like it's going around a big roundabout, essentially. And it takes 1 year to go all the way around. Mars takes longer, Jupiter takes even longer still, and I'll come to them a little bit later on. So the Earth turning once like this gives you 1 day. The Earth going all the way around the sun and coming back to where it started from gives you 1 year. And the Earth spins 365 and a quarter times in the time it takes to go around exactly once. And that's why we get leap years, because every 4 years, you've had four quarters added up. A quarter, a half, three quarters, and one. So every few years, every 4 years, you need to have an extra day in the calendar. Otherwise, you slowly move the seasons through the year, and that would get really confusing. You move them by 1 day every 4 years, which doesn't sound like much. But if you imagine, people in this room, if you imagine that you live till you're 100 years old, that would mean that the seasons would have moved by 25 days through your lifetime. If we didn't have the leap years, there'd be 25 days earlier in the year, which means summer would start, instead of starting when it does, would start nearly a month earlier. Winter would start nearly a month earlier. Everything would be moved around. So we'd have the leap years to correct for that, to keep the clock ticking perfectly. Now, all these other blue lines, so you see these weird egg-shaped lines, loads and loads of them, they're some of the smaller things in the solar system that also go around the sun, and they follow crazy orbits. These are things we call comets. Now, comets are things left over from when the planets were born that are much smaller. They're like dirty snowballs, dirty balls of ice and dust and rock. And when they're swinging and they're coming near to the sun, the ice starts to boil off because they get hot and evaporates into space. So a dirty snowball just a couple of kilometres across starts shedding ice and gas and shrouds itself in a big cloud of gas and dust that stretches back behind it, just like this here. So this is a comet. In the middle here was a very tiny snowball, maybe just a kilometre across. Now that's big compared to this room, compared to the school, but really small compared to a planet like Mars. Now this was a comet that swung very, very close and nearly hit Mars last year. And it was discovered from Australia. It's called Comet Siding Spring. So it was discovered from the telescopes down near Coonabarabran. So this was discovered by Australian astronomers, and it nearly hit Mars. And that's just one of many little bits of debris left over from when the planets formed that are all going around the sun on their own, following their own different paths. So this is just animated showing the planets going around. So all these green dots at the edge are asteroids. We have Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, little symbols. And you can see the closer you are to the sun, the quicker you move. That's because the sun's gravitational pull is stronger there, so it's pulling you around more quickly. So Mercury whizzes around really fast, Venus is slower, and the Earth here takes 1 year to go all the way around. And that's just showing the Earth moving. Now as the Earth's moving, it's spinning around as well, which is how we're getting day and night. And it spins 365 and a quarter times in the time it takes to do one full lap all the way around. Now the moon is spinning as well. It doesn't look like it is, because whenever you look at the moon, you see the same sign of it and you see the same face. But the moon's going around the Earth, and it's also turning as it does so. So it's a bit like this. So if we imagine that we have somebody on the moon, and they're really, really big, this drawing is not to scale. And they're stood on the point of the moon where if they looked up, the Earth would be directly above them, directly overhead. Because as the moon goes around the Earth, it's turning as it does so, they would always keep the same face pointing towards someone. So, actually, can I get a volunteer? We'll just stand up here. Grab the nearest person. Get you to come up. If you just stand there, imagine that she's the Earth, and I'm the moon. I'm going around her. Do you see that as I walk around her, I'm turning all the time, so I'm always facing in towards her, and I'm also getting stuck on the line. So do you see what I mean? You can see that as I've walked around, I've done one full spin, but because I did it as I moved around, I was always pointing towards you. Yeah, now if I was the moon and she was the Earth, you'd be spinning as well. So do you want to turn really quickly? So the Earth's turning day and night, and I'm moving slowly around. You see, I keep the same face towards her because I turn once every 28 days, and I take 28 days to go around. So in the time, can stop now before we get too busy, in the time the moon takes to go around once, the Earth turns around 28 times like that. So if we did the full thing, you'd get very dizzy and feel unwell, but I think you did really well there, so thank you. Really good job. So the moon is turning as it goes around the Earth, which means we pretty much see the same side of the moon all the time. But what we do get from the moon are phases. You see that? When the moon is near the sun in the sky, so it's low in the sky in the evening or low in the sky in the morning, we get a crescent moon like this. What we're seeing from Earth, we're looking at the moon and the moon has the same phase towards us. But the moon we only see by light it reflects from the sun. And we can only see the side of the moon which has light falling on from the sun and bouncing back to us. So you can see if you're on Earth and you're looking to the moon here, the only bit you'll see lit up is this tiny bit, and all of this will be dark, which is why you get the crescent here. And the crescent has the illuminated side is pointing off towards the sun. Sunlight bounces off here. So when you see the crescent moon, the thin sliver of a moon, the shiny side is always pointing to where the sun would be. So if it's setting in the evening, it's setting down here, shiny side down. If it's rising in the morning, it's rising with the shiny side down with the sun just below the horizon. And as it goes around, we gradually get the different phases here as we get more and more of the moon illuminated by the sun as it goes round. What that results in are the phases. Now the moon does rock a little bit as it goes round, so it doesn't quite keep the same phase to us. You can see it nodding a little back and forwards. But you get the crescent moon, half moon, full moon, half moon, crescent moon. So what's happening, if you were on the moon, if you were stood here looking up at the Earth, you'd see sunrise now. Now it would be midday, sunset, nighttime. Just as on the Earth, you'd sometimes have the sun above the horizon, you'd sometimes have the sun below the horizon. Because the moon takes a month to spin once, the length of the day on the moon would be 1 month long. The time between sunrise here, now, and then the next sunrise, which comes around here, would be one whole month. So the day on the moon is very different in length to the day on the Earth. The moon has no atmosphere, so it can't keep warm at night, and it gets really hot in the day, which means when the sun's overhead, you'd be so hot the water would boil, and when it's the middle of the night, you'd be so cold it'd be like 100 degrees below freezing. Really, really cold. What about the other planets? Now, this is the eight planets we have. Mercury, Venus, under the clouds, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. If we do this to scale, though, that's how big these planets are. So the Earth compared to Jupiter is really, really big. What about those? Well, Mercury, this is Mercury, is the planet closest to the Sun. Goes around the Sun really quickly, as you saw on that animation, which means it only takes 88 days to do one lap. Goes around really fast. So 1 year on Mercury is just 88 Earth days. Mercury, though, spins quite slowly. Even though it's really close in, it's like the Moon, it spins slowly. So 1 day on Mercury is almost 59 Earth days. Now Mercury is really quirky. It's a bit like the Moon in that it doesn't have an atmosphere. And it's so close to the Sun that when it's daytime here, it gets to almost 400 degrees centigrade. Really hot. It's not the hottest planet, though. We'll come to the hottest planet in a minute. The other side of Mercury, when it's nighttime, gets more than 100 degrees below freezing. So that's one of the things our atmosphere does for the Earth. It's like having a blanket. It helps keep us warm at night, and we don't have time, because our days are short, to get too hot in the daytime. The atmosphere, this blanket around us, helps keep the planet a nice, comfortable temperature for life to exist. Mercury doesn't have an atmosphere, so its temperature moves around much more crazily, and you really wouldn't want to live there. That's Mercury. The next planet out is Venus. And Venus is almost the same size as the Earth. And we think that back billions of years ago, the Sun wasn't quite as bright. We think Venus was probably very much like the Earth. It might well have had oceans and mountains and maybe even life. But it's closer to the Sun, which means it got hotter. And eventually it got so hot that it got runaway global warming. The oceans, if it had any, would have boiled off and the temperature would have started to rise. Now Venus is a really inhospitable, unpleasant place. Its atmosphere is 90 times the pressure of Earth, which is already a bad thing. The temperature at the surface is nearly 450 degrees centigrade. That's hot enough to melt lead. It's not a good place to live. It rains acid rain all the time. Really unpleasant. So if you were on the surface of Venus, you'd be cooked, you'd be dissolved, and you'd suffocate. You don't want to live there either. Venus is also really, really weird. It goes around the Sun every 225 days. So its year is about two-thirds of the length of the Earth's year. But it actually spins slower than it goes around the Sun. It takes longer to turn once fully on its axis compared to the stars than it does to go around the Sun. Which means that on Venus, the Sun would look to move the wrong way around the sky. On Earth, on Mercury, on Mars, on all the other planets, the Sun rises in the east, sets in the west, because the planets are all spinning in the same direction. Venus is spinning so slowly that the Sun appears to move because of Venus moving around the Sun. And so that means that the day on Venus, from sunrise to sunrise, is about 117 days, but the Sun comes up in the wrong direction. It comes up in the west and sets in the east. All very, very, very strange. The planet most like the Earth now is Mars. Mars is smaller than the Earth. It's really interesting for people looking at geology, geography. It's got volcanoes that are the biggest mountains we know of in the solar system. One of them, Olympus Mons, is 25 miles tall. Crazy big mountain, these things on the side here. It's also got valleys that, like this one. This valley is so big that it will stretch from Perth to Brisbane. It's huge. It's so wide that if you were stood in the middle of it, you couldn't see the edges because they'd be across the horizon, they're so far away. And it's about 10 kilometers deep. And all of this is evidence that in the past, Mars had water running on it. This looks like a river valley, like the Grand Canyon in Arizona that's been carved out by a river running down the bottom. But all the water's gone now, it's frozen down. Because Mars is really, really cold. On the hottest days on Mars, it probably gets about 15 or 20 degrees, so almost pleasant. But at its coldest, you're talking 80 degrees below freezing. But it's the most Earth-like planet. If we were going to go anywhere, move away from Earth and try to colonize another planet, this is probably where we'd start. It's further from the Sun, so it moves around more slowly. So 1 year on Mars is about 687 Earth days. Goes around more slowly. But it spins at almost the same time as the Earth. So if you lived on Mars, your days would be very slightly longer, 24 hours and 37 minutes, rather than our 24 hours. So if you lived there, it would feel very much like the Earth, albeit a bit colder, a lot smaller. But maybe we could change it. Maybe we could make it more like Earth, or maybe we could build buildings we could live in that keeps the temperature and the air right for life. That's where we might look. I will take questions at the end, so otherwise I get told off, and we don't want to be getting told off. Much further out is the biggest planet in the solar system. We have Jupiter. Jupiter is five times further from the Sun than the Earth is. And as I said, the further from the Sun you are, the slower you move. So Jupiter takes almost 12 years to go around the Sun once. 1 year for Jupiter would be 12 years long of Earth years. But Jupiter also, despite being much, much bigger than the Earth, that's how big the Earth would be for comparison, Jupiter's huge. Jupiter spins really quickly, in less than 10 hours. Really, really crazy. It's also got incredible weather. See this big red spot here? That's the biggest storm system we know of in the solar system. It's twice as big as the Earth. You put the Earth in there, twice side by side. That's weather. That's really good weather. But Jupiter's huge. It's got loads of moons, probably 60 or more moons, four of which are bigger than our moon or bigger. One of those moons is the most volcanic world we have ever seen. It looks like a pizza. Every time we take a picture of it, it looks different because there are so many volcanoes changing the surface all the time. That's called Io. The second big moon is Europa, and that's the one I showed you earlier on. That's the one with the ice cap where there might be an ocean and even maybe life, possibly. Not necessarily very likely, but that's one place in the future we will look to see if there is life elsewhere. Next planet out is Saturn. Have to include this picture. This is one of my favourite space pictures ever taken. It was taken by a spacecraft called Cassini that's orbiting Saturn that we sent there. And this is actually looking at Saturn from behind. So the Sun is hidden behind Saturn here. These are the rings, but you see this tiny little blue speck? That's the Earth. Yeah, really cool. So that's the Earth, just here, taken from a distance of more than 1.5 billion kilometers away. that tiny little blue speck. More typically, you see these kind of photos of Saturn. Saturn's a big planet. It's nearly as big as Jupiter, but not quite. It's really light and floating. It's got these spectacular rings. Now, these rings look solid, but they're actually made of lumps of rock and ice, the biggest of which are maybe only the size of this classroom or a bit bigger, just millions and millions and millions of them. We don't really have a good explanation for why they're formed. It could be that Saturn had a moon that got too close and was torn apart. Might have been a comet came in and fell apart. We're not entirely sure, but Saturn has the best rings in the solar system. Jupiter, Uranus, and Neptune also have rings, but nowhere near as good. Saturn's the best. Saturn is nearly 10 times further from the Sun than we are, so going around more slowly, it takes 29 and a half years to do one lap of the Sun. Now I'm 36, Saturn is only, so I'm 36 Earth years, that means I'm only just over 1 year old in Saturn years. Saturn takes a long time to go around the Sun.
I like that.
But it spins really, really quickly, just like Jupiter, 10 and a half hours. So you've got lots and lots and lots of Saturn days in your Saturn year. Further out though, Uranus. The first planet that we discovered with a telescope, rather than just knowing that this was here in the night sky was going to ever die. Uranus was only found 230 years ago. Now that's a really long time for us, but in terms of how long humans have been around looking at the night sky, that's very recent. Uranus goes around the Sun every 84 years. So far out from the Sun, 19 times further than we are, so it's really cold. It's about 4 times bigger than the Earth, and it spins about every 17 hours. And like Jupiter and Saturn, and also like Neptune, it has a family of moons. These are the 5 biggest. Ariel, Umbriel, Titania, Oberon, and Miranda, named after characters from a Shakespeare play. And they're big and varied, cracked, fractured, rocky little worlds. All really cold, because now you're a long way from the Sun. And the final planet out is Neptune. Now, I love this photograph. Neptune and its biggest moon, Triton. This was taken by the Voyager 2 spacecraft back in 1989. I was 11 years old then, and this was so exciting. You know, like, you guys have probably seen all the news about New Horizons, which was amazing. This was my New Horizons, Voyager 2 going past Neptune. Sent back amazing pictures. This was the final image it sent back before it flew off into space. Looking back, and we're seeing crescent Neptune, crescent Triton. This is a more familiar face of Neptune, a blue gaseous ball, maybe 4 times bigger than the Earth, again with big weather systems, another big storm like that red spot on Jupiter. Now, Neptune was only found in 1864. Really recently. Not really recently compared to me, I'm not that old, but Neptune was found less than one Neptune year ago. It goes around the Sun every 165 years. So Neptune isn't going to be one Neptune year old for another 10 years, something like that. It's going to be in the 2020s sometime that Neptune has its first birthday. So we found this less than one full orbit of the Sun ago. That's really recent. And it spins every 16 hours in a bit. So that's probably enough of me just talking to you. Lots of time left for questions. So, yeah. It's not full of water, although the core of Neptune, buried deep under the clouds, is probably a lot of ice in there. The blue colour comes because Neptune's clouds are mainly made of methane, the gas that cows give off when they have eaten too much food. Neptune is very heavily methane-based, and methane scatters light a bit like the atmosphere of the Earth does, so it looks blue when we look at the planet. And so it's mainly methane with some things like ethane, and buried deep down you have water, ice as a core.
Can I ask you to answer that question? I just want Jonti to answer these questions first, and then if you've got more questions.
Yep.
I think Isla asked this one the other day. Does the Earth orbit the Sun slower when it's a leap year?
No, it's a really good question, though. So a leap year has one extra day in it, 366 instead of 365. But the Earth is still following the same path around the Sun. The thing is, the Earth doesn't spin an exact number of times in one lap of the Sun. It actually spins 365 and a quarter. It's actually not even quite perfectly a quarter, but it's very close. So what happens is that if we have 365 days in the year, 1 year, the Earth goes around 365 and a quarter times. So we're a quarter of a day out. The next year, we've got another quarter of a day to make it half a day. Then another quarter of a day to make it three quarters. and another quarter to make one full day. And this is what I said a little bit earlier on. What that means suddenly is that you've moved all the seasons out by one day from where they were 4 years earlier. And so in order to fix that, we put an extra day in February of that year. We have February 29th, we have the leap year. And that brings all our clocks back to the right time, so the Earth's back where it should be. So the Earth's still taking the same time to go around. It's just we're adding four extra quarters, gives us one day every 4 years. That's where that comes from. We'll go through this list of questions first and then answer the other ones.
I don't know if you've answered this already, but Bella's written, why do we need the other planets?
It's a real good question. I actually talked to some people about this out in the solar, out in the courtyard. So as the solar system is now,
Henry,
we don't need the other planets. They're not required for us to live and survive. But they're like our brothers and sisters, like our cousins. All of the planets form together, and we form this whole system of planets, dwarf planets, asteroids, comets, and the sun, all in one go. As it is now, we don't really need the planets any more than you really have to have brothers and sisters. I don't have any brothers and sisters, and I'm sort of fine. I'm sort of a normal person, even though I'm an astronomer and sometimes a werewolf. I'm normal without brothers and sisters. The Earth would be a normal planet if the other planets weren't there. One way that we do need the other planets, though, is coming to how we think the planets formed. And we think that where the Earth formed, it's so close to the Sun, it shouldn't have any water. It should have been too hot when the Earth formed for it to get hold of any water. So where did the water come from? We know there's lots of water around. I had to clean lots of it off my car before I drove in this morning. There's lots of water. Where did that come from? We think that that water was thrown onto the Earth in the form of comets, like the one I showed you earlier on, these dirty snowballs, that hit the Earth, smashed into us, and deposited the water. How did those snowballs get to us? We think they were thrown here by the other planets. As they get near the planets give them a kick, throw them in a new direction, and a tiny fraction of them hit the Earth, and that's where we got our water from. So that's why we do need the other planets. But we don't need them today, but in the past they were very helpful. Again, we had a little bit of a chat about this outside, but not everybody was there, so we can go through it again. Ozone is a certain type of molecule. So the oxygen we breathe outside has two oxygen atoms held together like this. In ozone, you have three oxygen atoms hanging together in like a triangle like this. And ozone is very good at absorbing and catching ultraviolet light. The ultraviolet light hits it and smashes it apart, but that gets rid of the ultraviolet light. Now, the ozone's high up in the sky, so imagine that one of you is stood behind me and the rest of you in front, and the person behind me is firing, throwing balls at you, table tennis balls, so they don't really hurt me. If I'm in the way, they hit me, bounce off, and you're all protected, aren't you? The balls can't get through me because I'm a big wall against blocking the ping pong balls. The ozone's doing the same thing. Having these molecules of ozone high up in the atmosphere, the ultraviolet that if it made it to the ground could hit us and give us cancer and make us unwell, instead hits this shield high up in the atmosphere. Every ultraviolet light that comes in hits one ozone molecule, smashes it apart, but that gets rid of that bullet of ultraviolet light coming in and stops it getting any deeper. So this is why the man-made activities we were doing back when I was young, that were getting rid of the ozone layer was so problematic, because we were putting chemicals in the atmosphere that destroyed that ozone, removed the protection, and that meant more ultraviolet light was coming through to the Earth, which is why so many older people have problems with their skin, with skin cancers and things, because we thinned that protective layer down, so more of that nasty radiation got through and hit them, which did damage to them. And this is why we have laws that prevent us from using certain chemicals and releasing them to the atmosphere. Things like chlorofluorocarbons, which hopefully you guys maybe haven't heard much about. When I was your age, they were in the news all the time because we'd realised they were doing damage and we were trying to stop people using them. So that's why we protect the ozone layer and it protects us.
Okay. Why does the Earth spin on its axis going around the sun? You might have
a little bit, but I can go, if you don't mind me swapping to some other slides, I can show a pretty picture and tell you a little story.
If I just come back. You asked Jonti already, but other people might.
But other people might not. So, pop out of those slides, and go into this. So, the story of why the planets spin comes back to how planets form. So all the way through our galaxy, we have big clouds of gas and dust floating around. Leftovers from the formation of other stars, material ejected by stars when they die. And these clouds of gas and dust are huge. They can be so big that light would take 100 years to travel from one side to the other. Light travels so quickly that it only takes a second to reach the moon. So these are really stupidly big. Now these clouds of gas and dust have lots in them and are being nudged all the time by passing stars by the galaxy. So they are very slightly spinning in space, only very slightly. When stars and planets start to form, something causes the gas and dust to start collapsing, to be pulled together by gravity. And as the cloud of gas and dust gets smaller and smaller, just like an ice skater, if the ice skater is spinning and brings their arms in, they spin quicker and quicker and quicker. You've seen that, right? Now, that's something we in science we call the conservation of angular momentum, which is scientists using long words to sound smart. What it really means is ice skaters pull their arms in and spin faster. Now, a cloud of gas and dust collapsing to form stars and planets then spins quicker and quicker as it gets smaller and smaller. And it's not just shrinking in size by a factor of two, shrinking in size by millions and millions and millions of times. So what starts as a very, very slow spin becomes faster and faster and faster and faster. And all that gas and dust collapsing into the middle, the densest part of it in the centre of the collapsing cloud of gas and dust, gets really hot being 10 million degrees. And that's hot enough for the star to start burning its hydrogen fuel to make helium. Turns hydrogen to helium, releases energy, and that's how stars shine, how stars get really hot and how stars survive. But around that young star that's forming, the gas and dust collapses into a disk and starts falling in towards the star. Now this is another result of it spinning. Have you ever seen anyone in a restaurant making pizza dough? They get a big ball of dough and spin it really quickly and it makes a pancake. Same thing happens with the gas and dust falling and spinning, falls in to form a disk. And in that disk, that's where the planets form. The disk is spinning around the star, and in that disk you get little things spinning, collapsing to make planets. This is what you have. You have a disk of material around a star with big bits of dust colliding with each other, making ever bigger bits of dust, like the one we're stood on. That's the Earth. So the spin that started with that big star cloud, spinning a little bit, forming the stars, is still in here, causing all the dust to spin around the star that's spinning, causing the things forming in that dust to also spin. That's why they all spin in the same direction, because it's that little bit of spin that the cloud had when it started speeded up lots and lots and lots and lots and lots. And we actually see this happening. This was an artist's impression. These are real photographs with the Hubble telescope, looking at the Orion Nebula. So what's happened here is you've got this big dark cloud of gas and dust, and in the middle, lots of young stars have formed. And once the stars form, they start throwing off a wind, blowing off into space. They clear a bubble of gas around them and blow a bubble in the dust cloud. Gets bigger and bigger and eventually breaks through the outer edge and you look into the hole that they've dug. So you're seeing 3D here, just like in my hands, you're seeing the bubble created by young stars in here that they've blown out of this cloud. Within that, you have planetary systems forming disks around little baby stars. In each of these, planets are forming as we speak. And those planets will be spinning because of that spin left over from the formation from that big gas cloud. Eventually, the star gets strong enough to blow away the remaining gas and dust, and you're left with a planetary system and lots of debris left behind. And the debris are the things we call asteroids and comets, lumps of rock, metal and ice left over from when the planets formed. So hopefully that is fairly comprehensive in answering why the planets are spinning.
All right, so we might just go, if anyone else has got it. We've only got a couple of minutes.
Do you want to pick people so that...
Bella?
How you're saying if a ping pong ball hits the ozone layer, it reflexes off. But if the other planets have an ozone layer, well, does it... If it hits them, then what happens?
So what happens to the light when it hits the ozone is it actually is absorbed by the ozone and that's what breaks it. So it's not like the ping pong balls are bouncing off me, it's like I'm catching them. So what's happening is that that energy, the ultraviolet light, hits the ozone, smashes that molecule to pieces, but that energy is being used in breaking it apart, smashing it apart. So it's not reflected, it's absorbed. That means that the ozone is constantly being removed and it's replenished by chemical processes in our atmosphere and is the result of the fact that our atmosphere is mainly oxygen. None of the other planets have atmospheres that are mainly oxygen, so they don't actually have ozone layers. So one of the problems living on Mars, you're exactly right, is that there isn't an ozone layer to protect us because the atmosphere is not oxygen, it's mainly carbon dioxide. So if we ever wanted to live on Mars and to change Mars so we could live outside rather than living in buildings, we'd have to change the atmosphere of Mars to make it an oxygen atmosphere and to allow it to grow an ozone layer, a bit like an apple has a skin. So we've got to get that to happen. So at the minute, being on the surface of Mars would be very, very dangerous.
If you were on like Saturn or something, would you see the rings around it?
So if you could float in the clouds, Saturn's cloud all the way down to a core really deep down in, but let's say you could float in the clouds and you had a hot air balloon. You'd be able to see the ring so long as you weren't directly underneath it. The ring is so incredibly thin, it's just a few kilometres thick but hundreds of thousands of kilometres across. So edge on, it's like looking at a sheet of paper edge on, it nearly disappears. So if you were directly underneath the ring, you wouldn't see it. If you were above or below, you'd be able to see it spectacular around the planet. It'd be really pretty.
Okay,
tell me.
Are they the actual sizes of the...
So these are to scale for the asteroids. The smallest one here, which you can see, Dactyl, that tiny one, that's 1.6 by 1.2 kilometres across. So these are scaled up. This one here is 130 by 100 by 70. It's a big lump, 100 kilometres across. These are the nuclei of comets, and they range from little to big. Comet Halley, which will be back again in 2061, in a long time, is about 16 kilometres long, 8 kilometres wide. So these are all to scale with each other, but very zoomed out.
Isn't that one there?
This one? That one's slightly bigger, 2.1 by 1 by 1. This is 1.6 by 1.2. This one here, the little speck, is the smallest one. That's 500 metres by 300 metres by 200 metres. That's really interesting, though, because that one the Japanese landed a spacecraft on and then took off again and brought pieces back home. So that's an asteroid called Itokawa that comes very near to Earth, but it's only about the size of the field outside. It's only a bit bigger than that. Next question. You'd still give it a name to help you identify between them. So Uranus and Neptune are very similar. Until we sent the spacecraft past them and got those photos and we could see differences from a telescope on the ground, they look identical except Neptune's further away, so it's fainter. But we can recognise them because we know where they are in the sky, and one's nearer, so brighter, even though they're about the same size. So we find a way to identify them, but we give them different names.
All right, probably got now you have one more. So, please, yeah. Well, Jonti's got to have a break. He's going to have a drink.
I'll have a drink and I can keep answering questions, but we do need to move into the other room to talk to other people.
He's
got to
go to 5-6, so my last question.
Well, are you saying we don't need other planets?
Yeah.
You kind of need Jupiter because some asteroids get pulled in and could smash into Earth.
Kind of. So this is something I've actually done research on myself. This is one of my own things. I talk about this all the time. So the idea that Jupiter protects us is a little bit true. But it also throws things towards us. You know, so it just deflects things back and forth. So what I did was I looked at what would happen if Jupiter was bigger or smaller. Would that mean we get hit more often or less often? And what we found was that if Jupiter wasn't there at all, the Earth would be hit less often by asteroids and comets than we are now. But if Jupiter was about the size of Saturn, it would get hit more often than we get now. It's really weird. So what happens is Jupiter does protect us compared to if it was a bit smaller or a bit bigger, but if it wasn't there at all, we'd be hit less often. So what we're seeing there is, again, an illustration of how we do science. We've got a universe around us that is infinitely complex. It's really, really complicated, and our brains aren't. So we try and explain it by telling stories. And what makes them science is that these stories make predictions. We can come up with a story that talks about how the universe works and says, if this story is true, then when we get a better telescope, we will see this, we will see this. That's a prediction. Every time one of those predictions comes true, you're more confident that your story's a really good idea. But all you need is one prediction to come wrong, and then you know the theory was wrong and you have to come up with a new one. So for a long time there was this story, this theory that Jupiter protects us absolutely, and without Jupiter the Earth would be hit so often that we couldn't live. We finally got the technology where we could test that in computer programs, which is what I do. I run computer programs on the Zerl system. And what we find is that the story is a bit more complicated than that. So every time you get a better telescope, every time you get a better magnifying glass or a microscope, you learn new things and have to improve your stories. So our stories, our theories, are getting closer and closer to being a proper understanding of really what the universe is like. But we're getting there through this detective story of seeing all of the clues, of looking at the planets with telescopes, of running computer programs, of sending spacecraft to them. And they give us the clues that allow us to improve our stories, to better understand what happened. Or, in the case of the detective story, who the killer was. It's like the story about how the dinosaurs got wiped out. We have this unsolved mystery. The dinosaurs were alive and then something wiped them out entirely. It's a crime scene that's 65 million years old, and we as detectives have to go back and look at all the clues to work out exactly what happened. And as we get more clues, as we get more evidence, we then have the story of exactly what went on.
I think Jordy wants to go and spend a week with you.